Bonjour et bienvenue à tous. Thank you very much, all of you, for being here. We're so glad to see such large numbers in the room. Thank you. Donc, c'est la dernière classe de maître du programme de mentorat de l'Orchestre du CNA, the last master class of the 2023 NACO Mentorship Program this year. So for the last 3 weeks, we've had about 45 to 46 artists joining the NAC Orchestra on stage for rehearsals and concerts. You might have seen them last night or last week in some of our concerts, and tonight will be the last concert in which you'll be able to see them when they play Holst the Planets. So we're very much looking forward to that. Today we have James Ehnes will be teaching a masterclass to three of our violin participants. The violin participants will introduce themselves as they come up, and they'll tell you a bit about who they are, where they're from, and what they're playing for you this morning, for James this morning. And James, a little bit about James, I'll let him do maybe a fuller introduction, but to let you know, James is one of our creative partners. He works closely with the NAC Orchestra. He's been on tour with the orchestra several times across Canada and in Europe, and he's one of our great friends, and we're very pleased to have him here with us today. So maybe we can give James a good round of applause.
It's my pleasure. Looking forward to this.
Great. Well, I'll invite Daniel to come up and we can get started.
Excellent.
Thanks, Daniel.
Hello. I'm not sure where to look.
I don't know you.
So I'll introduce myself. I'm Daniel Fuchs. I currently live in St. John's, Newfoundland, but I grew up in the Montreal area. And I've chosen to play some of the Bach Chaconne, since it's such an awesome and important piece in the violin repertoire. I'm just going to play until about halfway through, just an excerpt. Will you stop me at some point, or should I play all of that?
I think half would be good. Like, are you thinking sort of through to the majore section?
Through just until the beginning of the majore section. Funny spot to stop. But
that sounds perfect.
Okay.
Great.
All
right, looking forward.
Thank you.
That would be that'd be amazing, an amazing piece if that were all it was, right? And then there's more. First of all, am I coming through fine in terms of the picture, the sound, everything is okay?
Excellent, yeah.
There's like a little bit of latency issue I'm dealing with. So it's like I'm seeing you a fraction after I'm hearing you, which is a little discombobulating, but not too bad. Yeah, it's beautiful. You know, I think that I'd like to talk a little bit about sort of bigger issues. There are a few things, like little suggestions I might have along the way. I'd like to hear you play from the beginning one more time. It's very difficult to make people understand where one is in this piece. You know what I mean? I see this is something you've thought about a lot. The two and one, two, because, you know, one's also important, right? So I don't know, there is the bowing issue. You know, you're generally speaking taking double downs for one and two, but not always. And that inconsistency of it is fine in terms of inconsistency of bowing. I'd like to feel maybe a little bit better understanding of kind of what's behind the decision of where you do and where you don't. I think that in terms of a sort of core of sound and solidity of sound, I think that if you're going to do the double down, you don't want to sort of whoosh through the first one, if that makes sense. I think that sometimes it took on a slightly different character as a result of the upcoming retake. Can you just play a little bit from the beginning?
Sure.
And if you see me sort of like shifting around, I've got like a score up on one screen and it's all kind of complicated, but I am seeing you. You know, just one little thing. The tension of that first chord, that first beat chord, I should say, and the resolution on the next first beat chord, can I hear more of a two and one, two and one, two?
Yeah. So you know, I couldn't hear you playing, like the sound cut out when you were playing.
Well, it sounded terrible. You wouldn't want it.
two and one, two.
And this is this subtle thing. If I look away, the first beat, the way that you're bowing, the first beat of that second bar sounds, I think sometimes of gestures in terms of, they can sound either up or down, and it sounded quite up, which really makes it sound like a one on the second beat. Okay, let's see. Is original sound turned on? I'm going to double check. My original sound is supposed to be turned on, but let's see if it actually is. Sorry, I'm getting, you know, automatically adjust microphone volume. I'm going to turn that off. I think that's going to be good. Okay, hold on a second. Can you hear now?
No.
No.
Still cutting out. Weird. Well, anyway, I guess in a very clear sense, let's see, what am I trying to ask you? Can you just play the first beat slightly longer? I think that might help. That's nice. I like that. I think that it slowed the whole tempo down a little, which I'm not sure I was up for that, but the sort of that wham, ba, da, dum, dum. I liked that effect. I thought that the chords spoke really well, and it gave sort of this feeling that we're going to get that whole time of one, two, and one, two. I switched something else now. Let's see.
Yes.
You hearing that?
Yeah.
Hey, I did it. Okay. So this next bit, you know, every violinist sort of has their own way of figuring out how to voice it. And I think what I'd like to be able to follow the voicing a little bit more clearly. All that sort of stuff. And I don't think you need to do that sort of whipping down thing that many people do, so that's not what I'm getting at, but I think it's almost a conceptual thing. You know, if you're really listening for that voice, I think you'll find a way to bring it out a little bit better. And it also sort of becomes a question of character, is what are you saying in this little bit? Could you take from the eighth bar and yeah, just think about what this first episode is saying in comparison to the theme. Can I stop you for a sec? Yeah, that was, I think, sort of the second time through, I was getting a little more of it. I think that initially the issue with the voicing of the chords was that we were getting a lot of the bottom note when you were breaking the chord. You know, I was getting the G string,
yeah.
And then of course I was getting the top because the E string is so, you know, naturally shrill. But then the second time through, the bottom of the chords before the break, you were voicing that D string more, which really helped bring that out. So that's great. I'm thinking we must have the same bar numbers, of course. Pick up to bar 16. Make sure that's a B flat on the bottom of that chord because you've been playing a G.
Oops.
Because it's tempting to play a G because it's like the pickup to bar 12, but not. So yeah, be careful about that one. Now this next variation, I think, is one where the texture can start to kind of thin out a little bit. So maybe think about this one being a little bit lighter, more sort of horizontal motion, but less in the string. Can you just go on from here, from bar 17?
Sure.
Thank you. nice. You know, the only thing I might suggest with that one is it's very clear to me that you are musically thinking through the top line, you know, the moving line. At times, as I was listening to it, I wanted to think about... is in a way that is a... that is more related to the theme, actually, than the top, which is just sort of a variation upon it. So maybe you can think about... the sort of tension release of those types of things. For the sake of time, you know, I think that we'll... I might just talk ahead a little bit here. I think it could flow a little more. Just, and it's funny, it's not necessarily like... I was trying to think of how to put that, because it's not necessarily that I think it should be faster, but I think that sometimes it's getting slightly, for my taste, a little bit caught up in smaller beats. You know, like sometimes I'm hearing 6/8 notes instead of 3/4, you know, things like that. Because I feel like the magic of this piece, particularly this sort of first half of the piece, is how it all develops. You know, each variation is sort of a reflection upon the last one. And particularly right from where we stopped, it's like it starts to walk a little bit. You know, it just starts to kind of swirl a little bit. And then it takes a tiny step back, perhaps. In that bit, but then it almost immediately gets back into those 16th notes. And I think that, you know, it's kind of amazing if you look from like bar 37, just even visually, it's like you just start to see a lot more ink on the page. And so I think the idea of the variations, you know, at first it's very clear, you know, we have theme, variation one, variation two, you know, and then it starts to sort of blur those lines a little bit, so a little bit more sort of forward motion through that I think could help. I'd like to hear a little bit from I guess it's bar 57. And one thing that...
Sure, just give me 1 second. I was reading off of a printout of the manuscript, so...
Nice,
I don't have
okay.
bar numbers, but I do have the book here, so...
Okay,
just give me
okay.
one second to find the page.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
Sorry about that. Here we go. Okay.
One thing from this bit at 57 here...
Yeah.
It's funny you mentioned the manuscript. There are, you know, these sort of... sometimes ambiguities in terms of the lengths of slurs or things where it's a little hard to decode. But one thing that I think is really interesting is a... well, I mean, it's implied at 58, but then... so basically that he moves it to couplets a beat earlier than you might expect. And I know you did a 3+1 on the third beat of 59, but I actually think that's a kind of a crucial, I think that's
okay.
something that he put in very much on purpose because it sort of links the two bits of material. And that ties into this idea that I was talking about before of how we want to understand the relationship between these separate variations. And sometimes he links them like that on purpose. But can you, don't think about that now, I don't want you to change your playing in the middle of playing, but could you go from bar 57 thinking about a sense of continuity, maybe, well, I'll have you stop maybe around 77, and then we'll talk about that.
Thank you.
Great. I was thinking maybe just through the next little one, but no, this is good. I think one little detail at bar 60, when that top line comes in on the first A, pick a dum ba da dee da dum, I think it's cool. I mean, something that he's been playing a lot around with two voices, but how we have these three voices coming in. It's really nice if you can make sure that we really hear that first A quite clearly, as a, you know, as a dum dee da dee da dum, so it doesn't sound quite so. That they're all sort of layered. I think as the note values were getting shorter, it was slowing down a little bit, which I think sort of, it takes away a little bit of the feeling of momentum and of the feeling of it almost rolling a little bit. So I think that at the, I think you maybe think about being kind of disciplined with the tempo so that you've got somewhere to go with it.
Yeah.
Shortly after where we stopped, I think that it's quite amazing. Like bar 77, from that point, I think that you have built up a tremendous amount, or I mean, you, anyone who's playing this, the music builds up a tremendous amount of tension to this point. And from this point, it really is all dissipating. It's winding down, you know, not right away. I think that it's important for it not to just sort of stop and then introduce different material. I think that this is sort of the wind down. To me, that is how one makes sense out of the arpeggiated bit, because this music, it's a little weird, you know? It's kind of introspective, and by the time you get to, it really is very introspective, and I think the arpeggio section is quite a private rumination upon everything that's come before. I think that if you can find a way through this whole wind down from bar 77 into the arpeggio section, so that when the arpeggios start, you know, that's the moment you really, you want your audience really leaning in, you know, sort of on the edge of their chair. So think of really bringing that quite inward. If there's playing before it that is really for the back of the room, this is drawing everyone in towards you. I think you can be quite kind of reticent through a lot of the arpeggiation section, of course building to the big climaxes the way you did, but then I think at 121 I didn't get quite enough, you know, at the end of all that stuff, yeah. I didn't get quite enough of a feeling of arrival, maybe, which is, so for me those 4.5 bars there, they felt slightly separate for me, because then we got back to the theme and it was like, oh, we're in the theme. They didn't necessarily seem like an organic connecting point. So I think by the time you get to 121, again, that music is there because it has to be, you know, it's like sort of, that's the only, that kind of bravura, virtuosic display there is a result of everything that's come before it, rather than a little bit of a standalone episode. I think, so it's little things like that. I mean, I love your basic approach to the piece. It's a few little things like that that I think will sort of tie it together. And, you know, this is one of those pieces that can either seem like, wow, that's a pretty long piece, or like a single kind of moment in time. So I think that's the trick for us players to sort of tie all those bits together. But yeah, I've got to move on now. But thank you very much. It sounded great. It was such a nice thing to hear that. It's a good way to start the day.
Thank you so much.
grew up here, and I just finished my first year of master's at Indiana University, which is where I did my undergrad too. And today I'd like to play Isai Solo Sonata number 5. Not sure if I should just play the first movement, do you think, or?
I mean, I'd love to hear a lot, but I think that maybe realistically, how about if you can play the first movement, then, you know, we'll talk about it. If there's time to play a little in the second, that'd be great too.
Okay, so the first movement is called L'Aurore, which also means like sunrise. So the entire movement is kind of basically the visualization of a sunrise. I'll just get this ready.
Thank you.
sometimes non-violinists have no concept of how difficult this movement is, you know, and it's not the all the flashy stuff at the end. I mean, that's hard too, but it's like, oh, this piece, the delicacy of it is so, oh, it's just so nasty. But you know, it's interesting with this. I feel like with a lot of Isaiah's music, you get this sense of him very much composing at the violin. You know, we see that so much with pianists who are composers, where you can tell they're kind of writing at a keyboard, things that kind of fit in the hands. And it's fun how with Isaiah you get that sense from a violinistic point of view, where it's like, it seems like he's kind of playing around with things, you know, all these kind of, you know, those types of patterns that he's so fond of, where that's just something that you kind of play with. And I think that this movement can have a little bit more of that sense of someone kind of making it up. Well, at the same time, I would actually like to hear at times a little bit more structure to the larger phrases of music, but a little bit more of an improvisatory sense to kind of the inner technical bits. Starting from the beginning, I think that this is probably slightly a factor of doing this on Zoom, but I thought there could be a little bit more of the mystery of the very opening. Like the very first chord felt slightly obvious, almost like it was sort of like, okay, now it starts. Like, you know, there is something of that feel of the sunrise, like you can't really tell if it's getting lighter, but it's probably getting lighter. So can you start from the very beginning with just a total stillness, you know, think of moving the bow very, very little. Yeah, and if possible, and I mean, believe me, I know how difficult this is, what I'm asking you to do now, but if there can be no dynamic change, you know, and it naturally want to make a, but I think if it's just all in this very, very intimate world. Yeah, you know, I kind of love that. It's like that gets all of us in the room to just lean in, and you're not giving anything away. It's like it can be very dramatic if someone comes onto stage and they are not even, they're not even engaging with their audience yet. Everyone is sort of leaning in to see what's happening. And then I think what's happening is, you know, becomes a little bit clearer onto the next line. I'd like to hear more of the sense of a ritardando through the triplet to the eighth notes, da, 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 da. You know, that there's something, I feel like he wrote it that way because that's the only way you can write it, but what he's actually writing is this sort of just winding down of it. And I think that for me, the interpretation in my mind of that fermata, both in that bar and two bars later, is that that last note is more of a pickup into the next bar than a final note of the bar that it's in, if that makes sense. So I guess a little bit longer on the fermata. Can you go from that? Well, what edition are you playing off of?
You know, I don't know. I got it from my previous teacher. It says www.msjworld.com, which I've never heard of.
Okay, so I think that's probably the same one that I'm looking at right now online. So, does the second line start with?
Yes.
Okay, great. So then when I talk about it, I can refer to lines. And,
that's
okay,
good.
Great.
I don't have
so, yeah,
go
for the second line, please. Was nice. A little thing, I think that those, I think, have different characters between the piano. Like, I think actually the beginning of the second line is not, it's not too soft. Then that third bar is a little bit more hushed, and I think that can be a little bit more shocking, that one, to then create the contrast of. And then I think this bit, it can be tonally quite beautiful. And I think this is where we really start getting into that improvisatory stuff, all that stuff. Can you take from the harmonics there in the third line? Okay, great. So here, I think basically from the calm of, let's see, what line is that?
Fourth?
Yeah, the calm, the second bar, the fourth line. I'd like to feel like for the first time in the piece, we're kind of in a stable tempo. And I think, yep. If we feel that wah, and wah, dum, da dee, da dee, dum. It's like, that's the first time where it's like, oh, there's a pulse. Nice. You know, I think we're ready to hear something where we have a better understanding of that. Like, that fifth line, that fourth beat into one was quite short changed. And it just, I think that it can start. If you're not a little bit more disciplined with pulse by this point, it can start to seem like, what's going on? Where are we? Because then by the time we get to the last line, it's again quite free. Anyway, I don't want to get too bogged down in this. Let's see. From the second page, can you go from that calm et mesuré? And again, with the idea of there's the music, di, bum, ba, di, dum, di, da, da, dum. And all the other stuff is just sort of, he's just noodling around on his violin. You know, it's all kind of violin-y filigree. Like, so right there, like, D-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-dee-dee. I mean, that's a pickup into the next bar. And I think the way that you stopped on the bar line, it made us, again, it made us question if, I like, the listener finally thinks they understand where they are, and that, that kind of broke our sense of, wait, I thought that was going to be a downbeat. Can you do one more time? Yeah, again, can you really treat it really as an upbeat? So we get the relationship between the three and the six. Yeah, one more time. I think from the second to last line there, I would keep the bows as he wrote them so that there's more connection between the chords, you know, because the first couple bars of those you did retake, but then as you went on, you did them separate bows. I think the continuity of the passage would benefit from everything being quite legato through that. You know, there's that poco colando, and it's the fourth line, first bar. I think that could probably, I mean, it's good that you did it poco, but it was, I think maybe you could do it a little more. Something how to sort of close that passage. And so that next bit, because again, from that next tremolo, then we're back into this sort of noodling stuff. It's like we've had these few bars of pulse, and I think that part needs to kind of come to a close. I'm going to have you play a little of the second movement. The that whole last page, it was really, really well played. Great job. I think, you know, obviously the most we can do to bring out that theme, that's great. I think as it gets into all the back and forth, all that, I think that it's very interesting the way he's paced the stringendo and then the sede. I think that basically the stringendo can go a little bit longer and the sede start a little bit later. I think the sede is really, there's an expansion of the writing. You know, you're going from four groups of four to groups of five, and you're crossing the strings, and I think basically let that be the guide to the sede, like sort of making sure that all of those notes are very, very clear. I think that sometimes I was missing the repeat of the bottom G's, you know, if it needs, in order for it to really speak well, if it needs to kind of pull the music, I think that's very much the idea. So just focus on real clarity to make sure that that all is coming through. And yeah, let's hear a little bit of the second movement. I might stop you just for the sake of time, but yeah, okay. I'll let
someone
you
know. In the audience, please, like, tell me, because I won't hear.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
but I mean, how could I stop? it was great to hear it. Yeah, you know, I felt in a way like you sort of hit your stride as it went along. You know, I think that the kind of rustic nature of this thing, maybe in the beginning I wanted a little more of that da dum ba da dum bum bum ba dum ba dum ra da bum. I think that in the beginning maybe sort of a clearer heaviness on 1 and 4, so that we're really feeling that 3+2 nature to the rhythm. I think that there were certain aspects of the first part of the movement where I was, it felt almost a little bit too earnest, you know? Like, the thing that is, I think, hardest in these eyes music is it's like, it's so technically intricate, and it all has to be extremely clean for it to work, but it can't really sound earnest or somehow like labored at all, or else we sort of get lost in the weeds with it. I think we have sometimes certain character aspects have to be really very, very clear. Can you just play a little bit from the opening, thinking a little less about playing properly, but giving us a very good sense of the kind of off-kilter nature of that 5-4 rhythm? In the dum bum ba dum rum, make sure that we're hearing the low voice there, the low A, dum bum bum ba dum da dum. And if you can think of it as 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and 1. So it doesn't reset so much on the second bar, that rather the fourth and fifth beats of the previous bar are leaning into that next downbeat. That had more of a sort of a country dance kind of feel to it. We just have just sort of 1 minute left. You know how we start, it's in the third page of this, where it gets quite complicated and we're bringing back the first one, the theme, dee da dee da da dee dee da 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 dee da da dee da, all that sort of stuff. I think that needs to be a little bit clearer. Like, I think to the audience, it doesn't know the piece, they need to sort of be hit over the head a little bit, like, hey, remember this theme, remember this music. It can get a little bit hidden in the textures there. So there were a couple of things where, just, you know, to make sure as you're playing the movement, just to, you know, make sure that you're really cleaning it up, there were a few spots where I was, you know, missing bottoms of chords or little things like that. And then the pacing of the whole last bit, I think, don't get too fast too soon, or else you find yourself in a situation where you actually have to sort of slow it down when there are more notes in it. So be very, very careful about not sort of letting the cat out of the bag. You know, I think the whole thing should really, it should be clearly at its most virtuosic at the end. I think that those triplets on the last page maybe got going a little bit too fast. You didn't have quite enough in reserve for when it went to the 30 seconds. But
yeah.
Anyway, congratulations. Thanks so much for playing here. It was
Thank
really
you.
Nice to be here.
I'm originally from Montreal and I study now in LA. at the Colburn School with Martin Beaver, and I will be performing the first movement of Sibelius' concerto. I have up until right after the cadenza.
Perfect. Yeah, that's great.
Feel free to cut me anytime you'd like.
Okay.
Thank you.
just work through it a little bit from the beginning. I really like your approach to the piece. You know, it's a weird piece. It's wonderful, but it's weird. Like, and I think we kind of need to lean into that sometimes. Like, and I mean, I'm making a joke about it being weird. It doesn't play by the rules of other concerti, and I think you're doing a nice job of, you know, sometimes people play Sibelius as if it's sort of somewhat related to all the other kind of late Romantic violin concerti we have, and his voice is unique and not comparable really to others, and I think that a lot of that we pick up in the notation. You know, I mean, who else writes a violin concerto where the opening statement is mezzo forte? Like, what kind of a marking is mezzo forte? I think it was nice that there was this sort of emotional reticence to a certain extent at the beginning. I thought the line could be slightly longer. Like, I find it fascinating how many bars go by before you see a rest, and it's that tiny, tiny rest, dee da dee da da da. That first breath. I mean, you've been playing for bar after bar after bar with no rest. So I think that maybe spinning a longer line with that could be helpful. From figure one, I think from my taste. you're really on the same path that I agree with, but I think that you could pay even more attention to, you know, the way that he writes this bit. It's all surges, you know, it's like waves, they come and then they break and then they recede. And I think that sometimes the receding is as important as the cresting. And it's just fascinating how he rarely lets lyrical notes go by in this passage without some sort of dynamic indication of what he wants you to do. And I think that sometimes this idea of the cresting and receding waves can be a little bit clearer. These things there, like with the slurs that go over rests, you know, it's like the music doesn't exactly stop there, you know, it kind of goes through it. I think, for example, I can't remember whether it was or, but for one of them, you know, it's not like you're doing anything unusual in this. It's like it's so hard as a violinist not to fall into the trap of doing what every other composer would have wanted, which is, you know, to put a big accent on the B flat. But it's like, mm-hmm. He goes to such great pains, I think, with his notation to show you what not to do. You know what I mean? Like, he writes in things that look weird until you consider that they are indications not to fall into the trap of what a violinist would normally do. And I think a great example of that is all of those diminuendos, decrescendos, hairpins, whatever you want to call them, on arrival notes. And sometimes I think you were very effective with those. Other times I think maybe you need to just kind of lean into the weirdness a little more, you know. You know, each one of those that da 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 da, they each come away from it, and I think that if it's clear by the time that the orchestra comes in with a big da da, that you have already, you've almost started to apologize for this shrieking high E, and I think that if you push to the end of it, the reinforcement or the interruption by the orchestra, it loses the point, you know? It's just sort of like, ta-da, you know, and I'm not sure that's it. There was, oh yeah, and in that A Piacere bar, whatever time you need, if we can make sure that that second beat really sounds like a second beat, da-da-da-dee-da-da-dum, whatever you do, that it's somewhat surprising how soon it gets to it.
Yeah.
Could you go from figure one? There, so see that the D through the F, that hairpin is important. I think that, you know, there's something with the motion of the bow, da dee da da, it carries you over that rest with the slur.
Okay.
One more time from figure one. Champion, you know, but that's the one to make sure that you hit the note and almost immediately apologize for it. I think that those da-dee-da-da-dum, that was really, it was amazing how you managed to do so much of that idea so quickly. I think, you know, it's hard to know about the character. To me, that almost sounded sort of forte piano-ish, so maybe it's slightly overdone now. I think the idea of it just being da di da da dum. It's not necessarily, you know, it's not clear where that hairpin goes to in terms of the lower dynamic, but I think that not too much of it, but it's just kind of the idea that that we're feeling the half bars. This next bit, the veloce, that was very good, very good. I think when you get to that largamente of I think that the connection between that high E flat and the low A, I think we want to make sure that that first low A is clearly not a strong beat. If it resets too much, then it sounds like we're on three or on one or something like that. And then the whole passage gets a little bit unclear as to where we are. That's a little detail. As you go down, I would keep that separation of voices that you had with, you know, with that top line. Like really that whole way down, I think he only stops it in that last bar of it. And so I think, you know, by that point, yeah, sure, it's kind of grinding away a little bit, but I think it's a really cool effect if you keep up that separate voice for a while. There's a nice transition there into two that you did. Let's see, so going on from the that molto moderato tranquillo, you know, at the largamente, dee da da dee dum da da dee da 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 da. Can we hear those four bars as more one thing rather than two? You know, I think it's natural for it to come across as da 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 dee da 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 as two things, but I think it's really effective if we turn it into one. I'll just take that arpeggio up. That was beautiful, but I think that what will help is, I think that last hairpin on the F harmonic, I think that closes a little bit more. Dee da 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 da. that sort of resolves, and then he reinforces the forte. So yeah, that was, it was beautiful through that length of the phrase, but I think it can just close, like that bar where it has the affettuoso in the second half of the bar, that bar is such a wonderful moment of consonance, and it can just, start that passage. And then one thought I have about this, you know, when you get up to that last A flat that you hold, and the orchestra has the rum, 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 I think I would like to be able to hear, now of course this is, you're not playing it with an accompaniment right now, so that doesn't help, but hearing it in my head, when you started that, it was hard to imagine that as a continuation of something else that has already happened. And, you know, I think that that doesn't mean you have to be strictly in tempo or anything like that, but the idea that really these quarter notes throughout this passage, it's an important motive. And I think that what happens right here, because it's, you know, you didn't play the second half of the movement, but I think that what you're setting up here, like this is such a beautiful moment, but if it's, if you really play it the way it's written there, with this shape from the orchestra that basically does this and then up to the top, so that you're growing from that piano into this mezzo piano, it sets up the second time it comes when it does that, and it makes that second time when it comes even more just like, oh my goodness. So I think, yeah, just thinking about the connection between those orchestral pits and then how you come out of that to the top, and then also how the way down from the fermata relates to how you got up. Like, to me, they sounded a little different. It felt like sort of this arpeggio on the way up, and then a broken octave element on the way down. I lost the sense of it being all one thing. It sort of goes up and hangs there, and then slowly starts its descent down. And as you were playing the broken octaves, I always want to hear the, and I started hearing, I was hearing too much of the bottoms, you know, which made it sound almost like it was written like a 16th note dotted eighth note, da-dum. I think make sure that they're always just a, kind of an incidental grace note. When you get to the bottom of that, with the trill, this is one of those bits that is written in such a way to make an already difficult passage much more difficult. I think the idea of the forte diminuendo, then you notice that these lines with dots, and then dots, and then lines. And I think that that's important. Mm. each one of them has a different character, and if you can do more to define those different characters, I think that would be great. And to also consider that the diminuendo, that when you come to that the trill, that diminuendo goes right to the crescendo. It's like that first isn't sure what it's doing, and then that is when it starts being like, okay, now we're getting serious. The next bit, I think that was really nicely played. Into the cadenza, I'd like to take a little bit of a look at that. I think that at times in the cadenza, you were letting the listener off the hook a little bit in terms of you were developing this tension and then allowing it to break. And I think that those bits of tension can go longer. Could you actually, why don't you just start the cadenza after that, and I'll stop you as we go. Again, there's one where it crests, and I think that there's a question of where that leaves you. And then I think from that point, this idea of the poco a poco affrettando, like, I think the second halves of the bars are interrupting the first half. That is what is causing the affrettando. And I think that by the time we got to the bar where everything doubles in time, I didn't feel like we really had moved the tempo. It was a little bit sort of stable. This next bit, that is physically, you know, quite awkward. I think basically if you make your string crossing a little sharper and a little bit torqued more to the E string, so that we have a very clean definition of the single note, double note, single note, double note. The molto moderato, dee 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 dum beam ba dee dum, I think if you thought of it as being just 2% more sort of legato in the line, maybe, somehow it felt like I'd like to hear the shapes of those overlapping lines being a little bit more like this. Like I would hear a line and then sort of a chord and the next line. Like I'd like to, you know, like if you were to draw it, they need to just overlap a little bit more. Then the next poco affrettando il tempo, I think, is the spot where you can really, from that bar, poco affrettando, I think even with the ups and the downs of it, you never want to allow that tension to break all the way through it. You know, there is that little tenuto and rest, da 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 da. So at that spot, again, that's the first rest that we've seen in a long time. You know, and I think that if that whole section, whatever you do, don't allow that thread to break, because then that allows the audience to just sort of reset a little bit. We don't want to let them do that. It's like, I think that ideally, when we get to the end of the cadenza, those last two bars are, I feel like they're deliberately composed to be a very intense and abrupt change of mood. You know, when the violin at figure seven, it's like it is still trying to be somewhat in this frenzied mood, and the orchestra part is so calm at that moment. It's like really unnerving, I think, and I think can be really, really effective that way. I'm sorry to say that that we're out of time, which actually is like a real thing for me because I have a rehearsal to go to. But so thank you so much for playing it. It sounds great, and send my very best to Martin.
Merci beaucoup, Yukai. Merci beaucoup, Daniel, and merci beaucoup, Delia, for playing for us today and for preparing these great works and for playing for us. This was really great to hear you. And merci beaucoup, James, also for your critiques and your coaching. I think this is going to go a long way to preparing our participants for orchestral careers and auditions and so on. So we really appreciate the time that you took with us today.
Well, that's always a pleasure.
Great, that's good to hear. And good luck on your rehearsal this afternoon. I'm sure it'll be great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.